Hello, everybody. Please welcome to the stage Denver Sustainability Strategist Sonrisa Lucero.
Good morning, everyone. Thank you. Welcome to the fifth annual Mayor Michael B. Hancock Sustainable Denver Summit. Yeah, I know, right? Before we begin, I would like to draw our attention to our tagline, Love This Place. We've talked a lot in the past about love, how we use it in our tagline both as a state of being and as an action. That by being in love with this place, we will be motivated to love this place. However, we don't often talk about the place or this place very much. Simply, it can be Denver or our neighborhood, both of which were part of our original intent. But this morning, we will ask all of you to think of the entirety of this place, the land, the nature, and the people of both the past and the present. We acknowledge that we are on the traditional lands of the Arapaho, the Cheyenne, the Shoshone, and the Ute. Yes. We acknowledge that those that came before and those that are present. Sustainability is so much about the future, about what we are leaving our children and future generations. And soon we will hear from our young leaders. But for the moment, I want us to hold the entirety of this place, its history, its present, so that we can truly love this place for the future. To help ground ourselves into this intention for the day, we asked Waterwoman Sharon Dominguez Lopez to lead us in an opening prayer. Ms. Waterwoman Sharon Dominguez Lopez.
Good morning. My name is Sharon Dominguez Lopez. I'm a native of Colorado. I'm a human rights activist. I taught for Denver Public Schools for 36 years. I infiltrated the system to educate my people. And I was ordained water woman over 25 years ago. My husband, Tomas Lopez, was ordained roadman. And at that time, I became the water woman. Water, as you know, is our most valuable resource in the world. And every time you pick up a water bottle, that water is no longer alive. So I ask you, all of you, to please stop drinking water from water bottles, please. All it does is contaminate our earth. It's up to us. It's up to us to take care of our earth for our future generations. So with this water, I want to pray with our most valuable resource in the world, water. Without water, we do not exist. Without water, there is no life. We contaminate our water every day, and we are all guilty of that. So at this time, I ask you to respectfully, in reverence, pray for this water. She's alive. She's in you. She's in this earth. And without water, there is no life. Thank you, beautiful water. Thank you for my life. Thank you for our lives. Tunkashila, Holy Spirit, giver of life. I ask you, Creator, Creator God, bless all our ancestors that came before us. Bless all those yet to come. And bless us, Holy Spirit. Bless all our leaders. May they lead us toward peace. Ask you, Holy Spirit, to bless our chiefs, to bless my father, my spiritual father, Leonard Emmanuel Crowdog, Joanne, his wife, and all of our Teoshpa'i. Tunkashila, bless all the homeless, the poor, the incarcerated, our soldier boys, our soldier girls. We ask you, Holy Spirit, to bless our children. We ask you, Holy Spirit, that you bless our leaders and may they make good choices for us. We ask you to bless the earth, the sun, the moon, the stars, the planets, and all of our ancestors and relatives beyond. Ask you, Holy Spirit, to bless all these people here today, these people that want good things in life, Tunkashila. And bless me, Tunkashila. Bless my mind, my body, my heart, my soul, and my spirit. Tunkashila, bless all my relatives here in this room. Bless your homes. And may Creator bring us peace. And may peace begin with me and begin with you. With this holy water, I want to bless you. Bless your homes, bless your families. And please remember, without water, there is no life. Thank you, and God bless you.
Thank you so much, Water Woman Dominguez Lopez. That was beautiful. It's powerful when multiple people come together and hold a common intention or purpose together. And that's what 1,100 of us are doing here today. Yes, we've broken the attendance record again. We include elected officials from Denver City Council, including Councilperson Jolene Clark, Paul Cashman, Debbie Ortega, and Amanda Sandoval. Please stand or wave as you're able if you're here to be recognized. We also have Boulder Mayor Suzanne Jones, I believe. I don't know if she's here yet. In the back over there. We also have our mayoral appointees to the Denver Sustainability Advisory Council. Council members, please stand or wave if you're able. And we also have over 70 volunteers who are working hard to make your experience today a good one. The volunteers are wearing bright green ribbons, so please thank them when you see them, and let's give them a hand now. So today we're gathered to learn from over 150 speakers in 42 sessions. You're here to network with over 60 exhibitors in the exhibit hall, and you're also here to tell this, you know, to learn more about what the city is doing and potentially push us a little bit further. And we are here to commit to action. When the mayor charged the Office of Sustainability to put on this summit, he wanted it to be a summit of action, not just talk. That is why he asked for commitments to action from both the community and the city, pledging that new things they were going to do to make Denver more sustainable. We have stayed in contact with those commitment makers to see how they're doing, and we have some results on their progress. If you could show the commitment slide, please. If your organization has made a commitment prior to this year, please stand or wave as you're able, and then stay standing or waving. Any organizations here that have made a commitment? I know there's a lot of you here. Be acknowledged, Iska, it's all right. And then if you made a new commitment this year, you could join this crew now. You're part of the team. And there we go. Thank you very much for your commitments, everybody. Over the course of today's summit, we'll be giving special attention to some of our new 2019 commitments. Each year at the Sustainable Denver Summit, we also provide updated information on the community's progress towards our 2020 sustainability goals. You can find a graphic summarizing progress in the middle of the program book. It looks like what's up on the screen right now. Finally, the summit is wholly paid for through the support of sponsors and registration fees. Today's event would not be possible but for our sponsors. Our presenting sponsor for today is VF Corp. They just moved their headquarters to Denver, and let's thank them and welcome them to the Mile High City. Providing continued support as well this year is our platinum sponsor, DaVita. Let's give them a round of applause. Our silver sponsors have provided some of the services that you'll be receiving today as the entire summit-wide. They are Amoresco, Colorado State University System, GE Johnson, Nissan, and Suncor. Let's give them all a round of applause. Our bronze sponsors are presenting some of our breakout session tracks today. They are Ambient Energy, Group 14, the Colorado Pollution Prevention Advisory Board, National Renewable Energy Laboratory, Swire Coca-Cola, and Serendipity Catering. Let's thank them. Then several sponsors have provided support that help us give scholarships to many of today's attendees. They include Centerplate, the Denver Office of Strategic Partnerships, the Denver Zoo, Jacobs Engineering, King Supers, Prologis, SSA, Visitors Services for Cultural Attractions, Stantec, and Xcel Energy. Can we give them a big thank you? And then finally, we have several organizations that have donated their time or their product to make today a little more fun and a little more enjoyable. They include Denver Parks and Rec, DocuKnowledge, Molson Coors, Sticker Giant, Tetulia, and Upslope Brewing Company. Let's give our in-kind and all of our sponsors a big hand. So So we're all here together to commit to action, to leading change. And what change, you may ask? Well, you can tell us. We have a Whova app, and as soon as I get off this stage, I will be asking you all what kind of change you would like to lead, because we're leading the change today. And so you can download the app and answer that question using also our wireless that we have today. So that is being sponsored by CSU and the app by GE Johnson. And you will also be able to see in the app the bios of the speakers, learn about our fabulous mural that was painted by youth artists from Platforum right outside the front door here, the indoor forest you're going to get a walk through today that will soon shade Montbello and Green Valley Ranch, courtesy of Denver Parks and Rec. And then you can create forum chats like the one, create or respond to forum chats like the one I just mentioned. So tell us in a moment, what change do you want to lead? So you can download the app right now if you haven't already, and you can log on using your registration email. If that doesn't load the summit for you automatically, use the code LoveThisPlaceSummit with title case, and you should be able to do that. There is also wireless instructions on how to connect to the wireless. It's the Love This Place Summit with the code CSUGREEN with capital G in green. So if you do all of that kind of things, I don't care if you do that while I'm speaking, but I do hope you finish before we bring up to the stage our presenting sponsor, Representative Sean Cady. Sean is from VF Corp, which has recently moved its headquarters here to Denver, and they are the parent corporation for a lot of brands that we all know and love, or at least I do, including Timberland and North Face and Dickies. I used to have my creases in my Dickies, as well as I kind of moved on to smart wool socks nowadays. But we're very proud and happy to have VF be our sponsor today. And so, Sean, if you wouldn't mind joining me here on the stage.
Well, thank you. Thank you for that warm welcome. And thank you to each and every one of you for welcoming VF Corporation to Denver and to Colorado. We are excited and proud to be part of this phenomenal community, a community that has a lot of similarities to VF Corporation and our portfolio of brands. We are sustainability focused, health conscious, and outdoor and active lifestyle centric. We are also excited to be part of this event today, an event that is action and commitment oriented, another similarity with VF. Every single one of us here today has come to make a commitment and to hold each other accountable. We are here too to do that. Today, we announced our most recent version of our sustainability and responsibility report called Made for Change. Our Made for Change report highlights our aspirations for advancing environmental and social improvements across our entire business, our portfolio of brands, our global supply chain, and in the communities we touch worldwide. Our report also highlights the achievements we've made during our last reporting year. You can download our report and read the highlights at vfc.com.
Some of us are creators who see an urban jungle as a playground where imagination can run wild. Some of us are explorers who climb mountains and move them. Some of us are makers, taking pride in doing things right. Together, we are passionate about the change we make and the impact we have. It's why we work so well together. One community, using our skills, experience, and unparalleled scale to preserve the world and to make it a better place so that future generations can do the same. In our fast-changing world, brands must step up to the mark. It's why we're leading the way, powering movements to inspire each and every one of us to live sustainable and active lifestyles for the betterment of people and our planet. At VF, we are made for change.
Well, thank you for that. And this year's Made for Change report highlights our progress towards our targets in alignment with the United Nations Sustainable Development Goals. We are proud of the achievements we've made. Some of these highlights include that over 50% of our distribution centers worldwide are now certified as zero waste. 16 of our key large buildings globally are LEED certified, many at the platinum level, including our yet-to-be-open new downtown Denver headquarters. And our VF Worker and Community Development Program has improved the livelihoods of over 150,000 workers in our global supply chain in countries such as Bangladesh, Cambodia, India, China, and Vietnam. As I said, we're proud of what we've done so far, but we also recognize there is so much more to do. At VF, we have a bias for action. Just today, we've announced our approved science-based targets for climate change. We commit to a 55% absolute reduction in our scope 1 and 2 greenhouse gas emissions by 2030. We also commit to an absolute 30% scope 3 reduction in greenhouse gas emissions by 2030 also, including all of our raw material extraction and our global supply chain operations. And lastly, as a signatory to the United Nations Fashion Charter for Climate Change, we are committing to become a carbon neutral business by no later than 2050. Our SBTs, our science-based targets, are ambitious, and they align with our ideology of using VF scale for good. In addition, today we announced our new sustainable materials vision, which is key to achieving our science-based targets. With the extraction, production, and manufacturing of our raw materials, they account for the vast majority of our environmental impacts. And this new vision sets us on a clear path for reductions with yet another bold commitment. And we are committing again by 2030 that 100% of our top 9 raw materials will originate from regenerative, responsibly sourced renewable, or recycled sources. These are just some of our commitments. They're bold, they're ambitious, and quite frankly, they're a stretch to achieve. All of us in this room know that climate change is the most urgent issue of our time. We have not inherited this planet from our parents. We are borrowing it from our children. We all have a role to play in driving sustainability leadership globally. We have made some bold commitments today, and at VF, we call on each and every one of you to also make bold commitments today. Go big. We need your action. The planet needs your leadership. It is my privilege to introduce you to an amazing sustainability leader, a leader who has positioned Denver at the forefront of sustainability commitments, policy, and action, both nationally and internationally. Please join me in welcoming the Honorable Mayor Michael Hancock to the stage.
Thank you, Sean. Thank you, VF Corporation. I want to thank all of you for being here as well. I want to thank all the sponsors for supporting this event today. And let me give a shout out to the office. You know, it's the Office of Sustainability, but we changed the name, and I think you can see it here in the front. The Climate Action, Sustainability, and Resiliency Office, and the entire team at Public Health and Environment. I know Bob McDonald, the leader of that organization, is here as well. Would you all just help me in thanking this amazing team that put on this great event today? There's Bob. Thank you, Bob. I'm sure some members of the Denver City Council are here as well, and nothing happens like this without true partnership and collaboration. And so if you would join with me, if they've been acknowledged, I'm apologizing, but as a mayor, I want to always acknowledge the true leadership of our city and acknowledging the members of the Denver City Council. Would you please stand and let me acknowledge Denver City Council? Thank you so much. Thank you. Councilman Cashman is here. Thank you. You know, it's been a big year for sustainability and climate action here in Denver. We earned LEED Platinum certification as a city from U.S. Green Building Council. We're just one of 11 communities worldwide to be certified platinum. We rose to number 8 on the AC's Clean Energy Scorecard, and we made climate disclosure projects A-list for the second year in a row. And for, yes, go ahead, that's worth celebrating, y'all. This is, you helped make this happen. And for this year's summit, I want you to look around this room. This year's summit has continued the trend of increasing the attendance for this annual summit. Look around this room. There are 250, 300 more people here this year than were registered last year. We want to thank you again for showing up, for being a part of this. But we recognize it's not just about attendance, for indeed a small group of people can change the world and can change Denver. But what's powerful about this gathering every year is that we come with commitments, and I couldn't be prouder than the fact that we have reached 280 commitments for action, including conducting energy audits on over 7 million square feet of airport facilities and 44 city buildings, expanding access to solar gardens for LEED-eligible families, and installing 50 more central control units in our parks to monitor our water use through smart technology and save water. We're going to hear about more of these commitments throughout this summit, but I want to thank everyone who has played a role in helping to establish these commitments, because we are committed to leading the change, and we're showing it through our actions, and that's the important thing. We're committed to leading the change because the climate change crisis that impacts the equity of every one of our residents and neighborhoods is real. We're committed to leading change because, in fact, climate change represents the greatest environmental threat to security and well-being of our community and our city and county. We can lead the change. We saw the passion of that when Greta Thunberg, of course, came to Denver back in October to spread her powerful message. And we're going to hear today from our youth keynotes and more young people who are leading the vanguard in the fight against climate change. You know, the current occupant in the White House may not think this is something that requires national and global action, but we're acting nationally and globally right here from Denver, Colorado, nonetheless. And I can tell you, I am standing as a symbol of mayors all over this country who are using the same languages and pushing the same actions as I am pushing. We talk regularly about the fact that we've got to keep going to work. But it takes community engagement. Cities, states, communities, and youth across the country are stepping up and getting to work, acting locally to do America's part in this global effort. Right here in Denver, our new Office of Climate Action, Sustainability, and Resiliency will work to engage the community efforts to reduce our carbon footprint, safeguard our historically marginalized communities of color who are disproportionately impacted by health impacts of climate change, and power our city with 100% renewable electricity. And our Climate Action Task Force, which is recently or is being formed, will be creating consensus in the Denver community by May 2020 to update our climate work plan with a focus on equity, secure the resources that will be needed to imagine a revenue mechanism to make our efforts and our goals happen. But there are actionable steps that we can take right now that can start making an impact we need on this issue. I know you already know this, but today, transportation represents 30% of carbon emissions in Denver and is the leading source of air pollution. That is why a key part of my mobility action plan is reducing carbon emissions for vehicles, which will go a long way as we strive to eliminate carbon emissions. Getting more electric vehicles on the road and getting more EV infrastructure built is critical to reaching that goal, as well as ensuring environmental justice and equity as Denver transitions to a carbon-free energy and transportation system. We can lead the change. Back in 2017, I remember it like it was yesterday, we committed to adding 200 electric vehicles to our fleet. And you know, we're going to reach that goal early next year. I remember when we made that commitment, we were all still wondering if electric vehicles would catch on and become the thing. We've got nearly 400 public charging plugs at 200 stations here in Denver alone today. And we're proud to partner with the Denver Housing Authority to pilot the state's first EV car share location in a mixed income community over in Mariposa. And in my 2020 budget, over $3 million will be invested next year to purchase electric vehicles, to continue our purchase of electric vehicles and invest in electric vehicle infrastructure. But leading the change isn't just about nice goals, and I know you know that. It's about turning those goals into just the way we do business as a city. And that's why we're going to make it a standard practice to replace our city fleet vehicles where we can, where technology exists, with EVs. I'm excited about this because by 2029, that will mean that we will have nearly 850 city vehicles on our road and as part of our fleet. But most importantly, it will mean taking about 11,500 tons of emissions out of our air. The impact will only be increased as electric used fuel, the electricity that is used to fuel those EVs from increasingly cleaner sources of energy. This is how we lead. This is how we can lead the change. Our climate is reaching the breaking point, and we can no longer afford nor tolerate continue to debate the issues of science. Sadly, I know you know this as well. There are some people, amazingly, a lot of them happen to be in Washington, holding high office, who do not believe in science. In Denver, I've said it before on the stage, we believe in science. We believe in science, and we believe we must act, or it will be our children and our children's children who will pay the price for our failure to address one of the most important moral questions of our time. It all depends on what we do in this moment, because that is what will shape the future of generations to come. I want to pause for a moment, and I want to give a shout out to someone who I believe elicited a very lively and important conversation inside City Hall about our approach to sustainability and combating climate change and resiliency. And as a result, you have the creation of this new office and some very important community-wide conversations. And while we may not agree completely on the approach, the ultimate aim and commitment is one that we do agree on. And so I want to just thank Council President, what's his name? Jolin Clark, for his leadership and commitment to climate change and leading these important conversations. I don't know if he's here, but join me in thanking him. And we'll remain committed to the change. And I know that everyone here is committed as well. And I appreciate you for being here and for your time, because doing it together is how we're going to make this happen. Now, thank you all. Enjoy the rest of the summit, and let's get to work. God bless you all.
Thank you, Mayor Hancock. I'm surprised I had to lower the mic. Come on, you guys got it. I had to get him back because he got me last year. He's coming out so I can make him look tall.
I'm sorry, could someone from facilities bring up her step stool?
All right, so after that, I get to try to bring to the stage Misha Palacek from DaVita. DaVita is our keynote sponsor, and Misha is, this is the fun fact that I really liked about Misha. He founded DaVita's Village Green Program in 2007, and that leads DaVita's efforts in environmental sustainability initiatives throughout the company. Please join me on the stage, Misha.
Right. Welcome, everyone, and thank you to the Office of Climate Action, Sustainability, and Resilience. And how exciting it is to see all of you who are here in the growing number that are taking action and making commitments on behalf of our planet. It's really, really exciting. For those of you that don't know DaVita, we're a kidney care company. We operate around 3,000 dialysis centers in the United States and now increasingly around the world to help people that have bad kidneys get dialysis. And so back about 14 years ago now, a little shortly after I joined DaVita, I was surprised to learn that we didn't have a strategy or approach to making our business more sustainable and thinking about how we impact the planet. And so a couple of colleagues and I got together. We had energy and passion for it, and we started what is now called Village Green. We had three foundational elements that we started with back then. One was to measure our carbon footprint and to start taking action on reducing it. The second one is when you do dialysis, you use a lot of water. We use over 5 billion gallons of water a year in our dialysis centers, so we wanted to start measuring how much water we use, and we wanted to start figuring out how to reduce our water usage. And then lastly, and this was a big one, was just empowering our 40,000 teammates and helping educate them on what they can do locally in their centers. And so I thought I would share just a couple of the accomplishments we've made since then. Let's just start with water. Since 2015, on an annual basis, we've been able to save 650 million gallons of water a year in our dialysis centers. Yeah, it's pretty amazing. For those of you who are swimmers, that's equivalent to about 1,000 Olympic-sized swimming pools, so it's quite a bit of water. On energy, we just announced earlier this year that by 2022, we're going to be 100% renewable energy. Yep, thank you. And that's pretty exciting. Since we have 3,000 dialysis clinics all over the country, we thought about all kinds of approaches. It's really hard to try to put up solar panels on 3,000 different locations in all the different states. It's hard to buy renewable energy locally at 3,000 different centers, so what we did was a power purchase agreement, and we're building large wind farms and solar farms in Texas that are going to put renewable energy into the Texas energy grid. On buildings here in Denver, it takes a community to move some of the metrics that Mayor Hancock talked about. Both our buildings here are LEED Platinum certified, and if you're here in the Denver area, we'd love to host you for a tour to check out some of the things that we've done. It's pretty exciting stuff. And then lastly, on community, Mayor Hancock talked about transportation being a big issue. Over 80% of our teammates, employees, teammates we call them, choose not to drive a car to work individually. So they either carpool, they take the train, they walk, they ride bikes, which is pretty exciting. And then lastly, I just wanted to say one of the amazing things that happened in terms of empowering our teammates was just putting a label on an environmental program back in 2007. Unleashed a bunch of local people that had passion for it that could now do things locally to help our environment and help our planet. And so the power of helping people channel their energies is really, really great. So with that, I have the pleasure of introducing our speakers. Four and a half years ago, I became a father. I have two boys, 4.5 and 3, and so that's only gotten me more passionate about the fact that we've got to keep doing things and committing to action on behalf of the planet. And so I'm really excited to introduce some of our young, engaged, passionate environmentalists to the stage. I'm going to start with Jamie Margolin. Jamie is a 17-year-old Colombian-American community organizer, activist, author, public speaker, and high school student. She is a founder and co-executive director of an international youth climate justice movement called Zero Hour that led to the official youth climate marches in Washington, D.C. and 25 other cities around the world during the summer of 2018. Jamie has organized countless actions for change and protests like the 2019 Youth Climate Summit in Miami, Florida, and the Youth Climate Lobby Days on Capitol Hill, both in 2018 and 2019. Jamie is the author of many thought-provoking op-eds from various publications, including the New York Times, and has been on both American and international speaking tours for climate justice, all while trying to get her high school diploma. Jamie is also a plaintiff in Our Children's Trust Youth versus the Government of Washington State lawsuit. Yeah. They are suing the state of Washington for denying her generation's constitutional rights to a livable environment by worsening the climate crisis. And she is a climate justice organizer in her local Seattle community. She's got a new book coming out, Youth to Power, Your Voice and How to Use It, which is going to hit bookstores worldwide in 2020. And finally, a bunch of really amazing awards that Jamie's won. She is won a Teen Vogue's 21 Under 21 Girls Changing the World in 2018, won a People Magazine's 25 Women Changing the World in 2018, Fuse TV's Latina Trailblazer of 2018, and one of today's shows, 18 Under 18 Groundbreakers in 2019, an MTV EMA Generation Change winner in 2019, and then finally one of BBC's Most Influential Women in 2019. So amazing list of accomplishments. Jamie, please come up to the stage.
Hello, can you all hear me? How is everyone doing? Okay, so I'm going to talk to you all about we're all here to talk about climate change, but I'm here to take it all back to really how it started, not the physical science of how we got to climate disaster, but how we really got to climate disaster, how we let our society get to a place where we could self-destruct like this. So I'm going to ask if the wonderful tech people can pull up the PowerPoint and let's begin. So, thank you for the wonderful introduction. I'm a part of an international youth climate justice organization called Zero Hour. As you can see by our wonderful clock logo, it is because this is Zero Hour to act on climate change. We have no more time. So, who we are as a movement, we are a bunch of young people who are fed up. The movement started in 2017 when it was after the United States pulled out of the Paris Climate Accords and Hurricane Maria slammed into Puerto Rico and just all of these different climate disasters were happening. My city of Seattle, where I'm from, was coated in a thick layer of smog due to the wildfires in southern Canada and no one was taking action. And our city was covered in smoke and making everyone sick, and that was the first time that anything like that had happened. And so after all of this, I said enough was enough. And so I reached out to a couple of young people who I knew around the country who wanted to take action on climate, and together we formed a movement. We led youth climate marches in July 2018, which kind of launched this new wave of national youth climate action, and had a lobby day meeting with many politicians. And there you can see pictures of our actions and some of our young organizers also meeting with different senators. But I'm not here to talk about that exactly. I'm here to talk more about the movement's guiding principles and how we got to climate disaster in the first place, because it is important that we get to the roots of the systems of oppression that caused this in the first place if we're going to solve this. So a little bit about the Zero Hour movement's guiding principles. We believe that those who are on the front lines of any movement should lead the movement, that youth leadership is transformational and visionary, and that youth must lead because we have always shifted the culture towards progress and liberation. And those are some more guidelines to our movement. So, and things that we affirm. Now, a lot of people, when they read our platform, they're a bit confused. They're like, what does Black Lives Matter have to do with climate action? What do rights for indigenous people, what do rights for people with disabilities and racial justice, what does that all have to do? And the fact that I want you all to understand is that the climate crisis does not exist in a silo, separate from all other issues. It is, and we're gonna get into it, the grand culmination of all our societal injustices that have been building up for centuries. And so if you try to fight the climate crisis without addressing all of these other social justice issues, it's not just that you're not being woke or whatever, it's that you're simply not actually addressing the root causes of those issues. So we're gonna get into some fun stuff. So first of all, what is a system of oppression? It's an institutionalized power that has been historically formed and perpetuated. And the ones that we're gonna get into today that are at the root of the climate crisis that are often uncomfortable to talk about, but we have to talk about, are colonialism, racism, patriarchy, and capitalism. That last word scares a lot of people, but don't worry, I'll break it down. So first of all, colonialism. This is a picture that when I was in third grade was shown as like, yay, manifest destiny. But not a good thing. So pretty much we can root back the start of the climate crisis and environmental destruction, not really with the Industrial Revolution. Yes, that was when we physically started digging coal out of the ground, but how did we get to that mindset of endless extraction? That comes with colonialism. There was a point where the people on this land that we're standing on lived in harmony with nature, and that was disrupted by this idea that everything is for the taking, that everything is for our extraction, and that other people and places are for sale. And that mindset that everything is mine, I can take it, if someone doesn't have a price tag on it, then it sure must mean it's for sale. That started with colonialism, and that has not gone away. So we look at these pictures of Manifest Destiny in our textbooks, and people say, oh, that's progress. But in reality, I see that as the root of why we're in this crisis in the first place. And we have to go back and address the colonial history and trauma that was started in order to actually get to the roots of the climate crisis, because climate change, and even though maybe at that point in time there wasn't emissions happening, that extraction and just taking of the earth in a way that is unsustainable, that's when it started here in the Americas. And so colonialism can be thought of as control over a piece of land by a more dominant power. And that control, that this is mine, even though it's actually yours, that putting price tags on things that should not have price tags on them, like air, water, land, that is why we're in this crisis. And so if you look at this map, this is a CO2 per person. The red means that it's the most CO2. So if you can see right now the colonizing powers of the world that's currently, you know, the current United States government, a lot of Europe and Australia have the most emissions. And those people, us in the global north and the colonizing countries, feel the least effects of the climate crisis usually. There are communities within us that do feel the effects, but if you're talking about disproportionately, the countries that are feeling the worst effects are the global south, the countries that have been colonized. So South America, Africa, and different parts of Asia, and you can see a lot of these places are in blue, which means that they don't emit. Blue means very low emissions. So they're emitting the least amount, but they're feeling the worst effects, and that is fundamentally unfair, and that is because of the whole system of colonialism and extraction. A lot of times people look at other countries and that are not, as we call, quote unquote, developed, and think, why are they so behind? It's not a matter of being behind, it's a matter of they were used for so long just to take and be extracted from colonial powers that now they're left the most vulnerable to the effects of the climate crisis by these countries, like the one that we're a part of, that are still causing damage. And if you think about it, also, a lot of the wars that we're causing around the world, if you think of the current still colonial conquests and wars that are happening in the Middle East, a lot of this is not just about, oh, war is bad, it's also, it all ties back to oil. So this is Fox News admitting, this is a quote of Fox News admitting that we go to war to protect oil. I'm not gonna read it out, I'm just gonna leave it up there, but pretty much what this lays out is that the climate crisis and the oil and these fossil fuels that we use to power our world that are currently killing us are also causing wars right now, are also causing violence. So it's a lose-lose situation. And so that's kind of the start of how we got there. First was colonization. Then we're gonna talk about racism. I'm gonna skip the video, but pretty much anyone who is feeling the worst effects of a system of oppression, whether it be poverty, whether it be racism, automatically feels the worst effects of the climate crisis. So, for example, we're gonna talk about the prison industrial complex. So people of color are disproportionately incarcerated, and prisons have become industries of modern slavery, forcing people to go out and fight the wildfires with minimally paid labor. So when you think of when climate disaster hits, when we have all these massive wildfires, when we have all these environmentally hazardous situations, who are the people who are being put in danger? It's not the rich folks, it's not the privileged folks, it's usually not the white folks. It's the, a lot of times, incarcerated people, and if you look at the prison industrial complex, that is created to incarcerate people of color, so the people who are out there putting their lives on the line to fight fires caused by the climate crisis are going to be members of most vulnerable communities. You're not gonna see a bunch of coal plants in Bel Air and Beverly Hills. You're going to see these extraction plants, these places that the corporations and governments know are going to harm people. They're going to be built in low-income communities and communities of color. And so when I said at the beginning, our movement says that we affirm Black Lives Matter, okay, what does it have to do with climate change? Well, right now there's an epidemic of police violence, of systematic killing of different communities. And the government making it clear and corporations making it clear that some lives are valued more than others. That's through gun violence. But when roughly 69% of all coal plants are built in communities of color, that's not an accident. That's because governments and corporations know that they can get away more easily with extracting from these communities, and that sadly the public and people are not going to care as much if these people start getting sick. And that is the harsh reality, and that is what we're up against. Because right now, whether someone is shot by, is killed with a gun systematically by a police officer, or whether someone is can't get out of a community and is living in a community where a corporation has built some sort of coal plant or pollution that is going to slowly kill them, that is still a form of systematic killing. Though the other one, the one with fossil fuels, is a lot slower. It's not as easily connected as being shot by a gun. It's still violence. That is still violence on people's health and people's bodies. And that is what is happening right now. And the communities that are feeling that violence are the ones who are formerly colonized or victims of racism. And those are what a lot of people do not want to address when we talk about the climate crisis, but that's what we have to talk about. And then, here's a fun picture, we have capitalism. And a lot of people, when I say this word, they get all scared. They're like, oh my God, she's here to start the communist revolution. No. We have to remember where colonization took us and where we are now. And right now we're in a system that means that profits are up here and human lives are down here. Right now, the way our economy works is kind of unnatural. So right now we have a trend of eternal economic growth. So if you look at the way our economy, if you go to economics classes, if you look at the way our economy is structured, it's meant to just have eternal growth, that we should just accumulate and accumulate and accumulate endlessly. And that would be great if our planet worked that way. But if you look at how natural growth trends work, in nature and just in humans, we're born, we grow, and then we mature. You're not going to grow for the rest of your life. And that's how nature works. That's how our Earth works. So when our economic system is set up to be completely opposite to how our planet works, then that sets you up with a huge problem. Because we're acting like we can just cash out infinitely when we can't. And if our entire business model and systems are set up to cash out infinitely, and anything other than infinitely growing and growing and growing is seen as failure, or anyone calling that out is seen as communism, then that's a huge problem. And whether you're liberal or conservative, this is not me coming up here, hi, I'm from Seattle, here is my liberal gibberish, no. This is not about politics, it's about what our planet can scientifically handle. And right now, whether you're conservative, whether you're liberal, our planet simply cannot handle the eternal extraction that our current capitalist system is putting on it. So. Then there's patriarchy. So this is some people, I really recommend everyone read a book called The Chalice and the Blade, because some people actually pit patriarchy as the very original system of oppression that even led to colonialism in the first place. So patriarchy is not just about sexism, it's a system of top-down organization usually led by a male patriarch, and it's sexism, but it's also just it's the whole system that is set up against women, against queer people, against anyone who is not, like, you know, the man. And that is a lot of people, when I start talking about sexism, so I got a lot of trolls, just in general, but I got a lot of trolls especially mad at me on social media, A, because I'm a woman on the internet, but B, because for my quote for like the BBC 100 Women thing, I quoted Gina McCarthy saying that the climate crisis is a man-made issue, which is why women should rule the world. And it was partially a joke, but partially not. and the reason why I say this is I'm not trying to cause anything, but what I'm saying is that if we look at who is in charge of these corporations who are causing this problem and who is perpetuating a lot of these systems, it is the patriarchy, and it is the problem when you have only men in power. And so when we talk about solving the climate crisis, we also have to address this. Now, why? Well, women are more impacted by the climate crisis than men. Don't take it from me, take it from the United Nations. So 80%, that's a very large number, of people displaced by climate change are women, and the reason is that we're just more likely to experience poverty and be less independent than men, because the system is set up to have women, especially in a lot of countries in the global south, have women be dependent upon men, and just the world makes it just harder for us to get by, and it makes it even harder for whatever other identity you tack onto that. If you're a queer woman, if you're a woman of color, it gets perpetually harder. And so that is something that we also have to address. And so when we talk about addressing the root systems of oppression that caused the climate crisis in the first place, we have to talk about colonialism, we have to talk about patriarchy and racism and capitalism. And I'm gonna skip through the rest of the PowerPoint because I see that my time is up, but what do we do now? So we have all of these, we know how we got here now. We know that the climate crisis is not the problem, it is the symptom of the problems. And so when we have to, let's say that you have a weed that you're trying to kill. Do you snip the weed by the stem so it can grow back, or do you pull it up by the roots? You pull it up by the roots so it dies and it never comes back. And right now with the climate crisis, it's a symptom. It's a symptom of colonialism, it's a symptom of racism, it's a symptom of capitalism, and it's a symptom of patriarchy. And so we have to treat the root cause of the sickness. And so when we're all here together to solve the climate crisis, we're all here together because we believe that this is wrong, and that we know that we're literally in a place that we have to decide within the next few years whether humanity is going to survive or whether we're not. And so a lot of people, when I talk about this, they see this as a burden. Like, okay, yeah, we'll deal with the social justice things later. First, we need to save the planet. That is fundamentally wrong, because the planet is not separate from people, is not separate from all of these other issues. So what I want you to take away from this is when you're going about whatever you're doing, solving the climate crisis, maybe working on more sustainable solutions, think, am I using the same thinking that caused the climate crisis in the first place? Am I perpetuating any of these systems? Now, with capitalism, that's a bit tricky because I'm not saying, okay, no more business, let's all go live in a commune, no. I'm saying that you need to be careful, especially if you're a business leader, of are you putting the bottom line first or are you putting people first within businesses, because that has to change. Because this is 0 hour to act on the climate crisis. So everyone needs to be doing their part, but everyone also needs to be doing the tricky hard work of dismantling everything that we've been taught. Because right now we're in an existential threat and we have to unlearn everything that we've been taught to value. Because right now, especially in the United States, our supposedly American values go right up against solving the climate crisis. Greed, gluttony, endless consumption, glamour, all of those things are directly contradictory to solving climate change. So I encourage you all to challenge yourselves. I encourage you all to think about how we got here and think about how you can dismantle those systems. So if you want to learn more, you can follow Zero Hour on social media or go to our website, and I'm going to be here for most of the day so you can come talk to me. Thank you so much, and let's do this.
Thank you, Jamie. That's so cool and so impressive and inspiring. So next up is Thomas Lopez Jr., who was born and raised right here in Denver, Colorado. He has worked with the International Indigenous Youth Council on the ground at Standing Rock to stop construction of the Dakota Access Pipeline and continues his work with the IIYC to inspire young Indigenous and LGBTQ+ leaders to create authentic, sustainable change. Thomas is also an active board member and mentor with the IIYC. Thomas was recently honored as one of the Advocates Champion of Pride for 2019. Please welcome Thomas to the stage.
Thank you so much, Jamie. I just want to tell you I'm really honored to stand next to you in this movement. I really am. And I'm really honored to follow that. That was really a great way to start this. So again, give it up to our young leaders and all of the young leaders across the globe who are standing up against tyranny. Ya'at ebene hihani washte tlaso kamali ometeo. Buenos dias. Good morning. My name is Tomas Lopez Jr. My mother is Waterwoman Sharon Dominguez. My father is Sundance Chief Tomas Lopez Sr. And my grandfather is Chief of Chiefs Emmanuel Leonard Crow Dog Sr. I am Otomi, Diné, Apache, and Chichangu Lakota. I'm not really a scholar. I'm not a prodigy. To be completely honest, I'm probably what a lot of you would have considered a bad kid. I've always been really rebellious, and I've always noticed that I never really fit in, no matter where I went and no matter how hard I tried. I descend from displaced and frontline communities, whether it be the forced removal of indigenous peoples, or it be the gentrified neighborhood of the Great East Side neighborhood that I come from. Yes, Mayor Hancock, I'm from the neighborhoods that you put up for sale. I am a two-spirit person and a proud member of Denver's LGBTQ+ community. So I trusted Cory Gardner before he showed his true colors and proved to us that white supremacy and accepting profits from oil industries was more important than standing by the talk and instead of walking what he spoke. I'm really no one that special. I'm just someone who's really sick of putting my trust in politicians and scientists who continue to let me down generation after generation after generation. I attended Denver School of the Arts, and after I went to Metro State University, where I worked for my bachelor's degree in technical communications and a minor in Indigenous Studies. When I got out of college with my awesome degree and my bag loads of student debt, I tried to find the amazing job that I was promised, and unfortunately, I was let down again. So I was sitting there and I was selling retail to people, selling things to people that they really didn't need. And I heard about this group of young people who was traveling from North Dakota all the way to Washington, D.C. to deliver, at the time, President Obama, a message that he should honor his word and defend their community against construction of the Dakota Access Pipeline. These young people were ignored, and upon them being ignored, they ran all the way back to North Dakota, where they made the call to youth across Turtle Island from Alaska to La Tierra de Fuego to meet them in Standing Rock, North Dakota, and defend the drinking water of millions of people downstream against construction of the Dakota Access Pipeline. I was one of the many young people that answered that call. Unshimaka, Mother Earth, asked something of me. She asked something of all of us, and so I responded to that call. While I was there, I met a young woman by the name of Jacelyn Charger, one of our lieutenants and leaders in the movement. She told me near our fire one night about the prophecy of the seventh generation and the black snake. It was prophesized seven generations ago that a black snake would come to the land, that this black snake would infect the fire, the water, the four winds, the earth, and lastly, the people, that it would infect our minds, our bodies, our hearts, and our spirits. Every great relationship that I've seen has been built on communication, respect, and reciprocity. We've stopped communicating with the natural earth around us. We've stopped respecting our sacred ecosystems, and we're taking from the earth faster than she can replenish. We have created a toxic relationship with the earth, and as a result, we've created toxic relationships with ourselves and the people around us. She also told me that it would be the seventh generation that would come to the people, that would bring back all of the medicine that was taken from us, that they would be the spear point to kill the black snake. I'm honored to tell everybody that we're living out this prophecy now, that every single one of these young people, like Jamie, like Chutesca Martinez, like Chie, were prophesized about. Seven generations ago, our ancestors put down prayers and tobacco so we could be here to fight against the black snake. I was born and raised right outside of a small city and community called Commerce City. Commerce City is an 80% Latino, Indigenous, Black, and working community. Commerce City is also the home to the Suncor Refinery. The Suncor Refinery has knowingly and continued to pollute the land and air in the surrounding communities, resulting in Denver's F-grade air quality. Suncor has repeatedly violated air permits, releasing more than 800,000 tons of toxic chemicals into the air, including 14.1 tons of hydrogen cyanide. And if you don't know what that is, you can look that up yourself. Between December 2018, just 1 year ago, and between December 2018 and September 2019, Suncor had over 2,000 violations, and that's in less than 1 year. Because of the Suncor Refinery, the zip code and place where I call home is now one of the most polluted zip codes in the U.S., standing next to Ponca City, Oklahoma. Whilst we're all gathered here to find solutions to this, We also have to be looking deeper at what it is that things like this are being sponsored by. When I look at the list of sponsors on these boards, I see corporations like Suncor. I see corporations like Coca-Cola. I see places that have yet to divest from Wells Fargo, US Bank, Chase Bank, all of these banks who continue to perpetuate the same violence and genocide against indigenous, black, and POC communities. Make no mistake, Suncor, I am not here to be your friend. I am not here to sit at a mediation table and meet you halfway. That time has long passed. I am here to tell you that we do not want you in our communities anymore. Drastic measures are going to have to be taken in order for us to win this. Drastic measures are going to have to be taken in order to ensure the safety of the next seven generations. Not for you, for your children, for your grandchildren, for your great-grandchildren, for your great-great-grandchildren, for all of the children seven generations from now that none of you will know. Take a stand. Corporations like Suncor are not here to help us defeat the black snake. Corporations like Suncor are the black snake. A lot of what I'm talking about is not scientific. It's not anything that you'll read in a book. It's ancestral knowledge that has been passed down for me for seven generations. When we talk about climate justice, we must talk about social justice. When we talk about social justice, we must talk about the black and brown women who are at the brute end of all of this. So how does this all relate? What do people have to do with the climate crisis? What do black and brown women have to do with the climate issue, or you in any way? Well, as we all know, money leaves a trail. The same banks that are investing in privatized prisons, killing black and brown women at an exponential rate, the same banks that are funding man camps who lead to the sex trade of indigenous girls and women and trans peoples, the same banks that are funding all of the genocidal camps who are locking up our children at the borders, are the very same banks that are funding these resource extractive industries. It's all tied together. If you bank with Wells Fargo, if you bank with US Bank, if you bank with Chase Bank, you are supporting the continued genocide of black and brown and indigenous peoples. We must prioritize our youth, our femme, frontline, indigenous, POC, and queer communities. We've all been silenced for too long. I know that a lot of you are probably looking at me and saying, wow, he sounds really angry. How radical of him. But I'm not that radical. I'm speaking something that millions of young people have been thinking. I'm speaking the words that my ancestors and the seven generations before me taught me. Because who better to speak for the voice of the past than the voice of the future? I also want to ask you, especially this office here, stop blaming the consumer. It is not the consumer's fault that we are in this position. It is because those major mass corporations that are poisoning our land, our air, our earth, and our water, and they have been poisoning us for years knowingly. It is not the fault of poor black and brown peoples, nor is it our responsibility to clean it up. We're living in a time where accountability is everything. And to all of our political leaders, know this, there is no amount of political power that leaves you exempt from impeachment. Like I said, I'm not a scholar. I'm not a wealthy person. I'm not a prince. I'm not a prodigy. I'm not a climate celebrity. I'm just a person. I'm a person that spent 9 months engulfed in water. I'm a person that has a mother, a grandmother, aunties, nieces. And every time I see a layer of pipe laid into the ground, I'm reminded of the sexual assault that we all have to go through. Because the same things that we're doing to our earth, we're doing to our women. I'm not afraid. I'm not afraid anymore to stand up against unjust governments, against greedy corporations, against homophobia or white supremacy or racism. I'm not afraid anymore. They've taken everything from us. We have nothing left. You've taken our land. You've taken our language. You cut our hair. You took our culture. And now you've come for our air, our water, our fire, our earth. But we will fight. With all of the youth of the world, we stand together as one. We're uniting. We have leaders like Jamie standing before us, teaching us about the past so that we can move into this next generation. It's not Generation Z. This is the first generation of an entire new era. And I'm honored to have been by you. And to all of those young people out there who are fighting against whatever it is, whether it's an unjust judicial system, whether it's pipelines, fracking. Remember that you were prophesied about. Remember that you are powerful. Remember that you can make a change. And that today, it's all of these adults standing here trying to help the next generation, but tomorrow it will be us. And remember that. I want to thank all of my International Indigenous Youth Council, all of the young people who have been maced, who have fought for their lives. Oh, I didn't even play that. All the young people whose land, air, and water is being poisoned, who are fighting on the front lines wherever you're at, we see you, we feel you, and your spirit has been brought to this room. Your stories will be seen, your stories will be heard. And I want to leave you all with a song that was created while we were in the Great Plains of North Dakota. I spent 3 months there. I was arrested. I witnessed all that this country has to offer, the true spirit of America, I like to call it. I saw what these oil corporations are willing to do. I saw their lack of care for humanity. So I leave you with this song. This song translates to Mother Earth. She is powerful, and her blood is sacred. Her water is life. Dakota Access Pipeline, Keystone XL Pipeline is bad for the people, but the people will stand together and the people will take courage.
Johnny Wakayela, hey, hey, oh, DAPLE Lila Zijan.
Thank you, Mama. Aho mi takuye oyasin, all my relations. And thank you, Sonrisa.